Which laboratory indicator of sepsis is very helpful to differentiate bacterial and infectious causes from non-infectious causes leading to the development of systemic inflammatory response? Can you give me an example of a non-infectious condition which can lead to development of SIRS, systemic inflammatory response syndrome? You heard of ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. When do you call ARDS? Whenever sepsis, infectious cause, is underlying cause for developing non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, you call it as ARDS. Agreed? And sepsis. Whereas if it is a non-infectious causes, you try to call it as SIRS, systemic inflammatory response syndrome, non-infectious. So is there any way to differentiate between the two? Procalcitonin is a very important marker. Earlier they used a lot of other markers like culture report, etc. If culture report is positive, infectious. If it is negative, non-infectious. But later on they found that won't help. But they found procalcitonin a very good marker to know whether a patient who has a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, is it because of infectious cause, sepsis, or non-infectious cause like acute pancreatitis. Is an example of a non-infectious cause of the systemic inflammatory response syndrome is what need to be remembered. Now here different graphics of coli have been presented to you. Which is an intestinal coli, biliary coli, ureteric coli? You have to differentiate. One very common aphorism in surgery textbook you must have read. One of the colis is called as not a true coli. Biliary coli. Why? Because it will peak like this and it typically remains in that peak. And then it vanishes. But coli means it should come waxing and waning. So biliary coli must be the graph 2. So that is the reason the only option is either A or B, then should be the answer. But option B is true because the graph 1 is very typical of the classical ureteric coli is what we need to finally understand. That ureteric coli is peaks of the pain superimposed upon a dull background ache is basically called as the ureteric coli is what we should understand. Now let us talk about tracheostomy. Somebody who is having respiratory obstruction, if you happen to do tracheostomy, he will go into apnea. Why? Whenever there is a respiratory obstruction, what happens? Carbon dioxide levels will increase and that stimulates the respiratory center and breathing is going on. Suddenly you have done tracheostomy and washed out the carbon dioxide. So that stimulus for respiration is gone and he goes into apnea. That is what we should understand. Now in this context, tell me doctor, what do you mean by type 1 and type 2 respiratory failure? High PCO2 with a low PO2 is called as type 2. Very good. And normal PCO2 with a low PO2 is called type 1. And if there is a pulmonary edema, you get type 1 or type 2? No. Pulmonary edema. In the pulmonary edematous fluid, carbon dioxide can diffuse 40 times. Only oxygen cannot. So hypoxia with a normocapnia will be there. Agreed? Whereas if you have a severe bronchospasm, late stage of asthma, neither oxygen can come in nor CO2 can go out. Hence it is an example of type 2. Simple to remember is, if the pathology is at the level of the trachea, hanging, you are hanging a person, he goes into type 2. Neither CO2 comes out nor oxygen goes in. If the pathology is at the level of the alveolar level, like pulmonary edema, oxygen can still travel, but CO2 can travel, but oxygen cannot. So it becomes a type 2. That's what we need to understand. Now a 16-month-old infant, male infant, with an enlarging abdominal mass and vinyl mandelic acid is positive and the small tumor cells with hyperchromatic nuclei with a little or no cytoplasm. It's a striptease. All clues had been given to you. And which malignancy we like to consider it as? Classically, it is a story of neuroblastoma, which presents with abdominal pain, typically in this age group. And what we have is a monotonous population. Monotonous means similar looking population. Agreed? Of hyperchromatic cells with scant cytoplasm is basically what you come across in the case of the neuroblastoma, is what you have to understand. So this is a typical CT abdomen where you find a retroperitoneal mass in the upper pole of the left kidney, which is a neuroblastoma. And this is another example of a right adrenal bleed in a neonate into the neuroblastoma, where it presents like a adrenal mass, is what need to be remembered. Where is the telomerase activity is absent? Now, what is a misnomer about telomerase? Ace means we generally think it cuts. But what does telomerase will be doing? It will be adding. Adding what? Typically, telomerase is an enzyme that adds few repeats of DNA sequence to the three end of the DNA strand. So that is what telomerase will be doing. By doing that, what it is doing? Whenever a cell is dividing, it loses a small part of its tail. And unless this telomerase is available and it joins that shortened part, the cell cannot further replicate. So presence of telomerase is required for a continuously replicating cell like a stem cell. But somatic cell is senior. It is no more sensitive. Death ho, patient is sick or serious, anything, you are continuing to go in the same fashion with a smiling face. That's called as becoming a professor. You already have seen enough deaths, so death doesn't bother you anymore. If you are like that in housemanship only, that is a little pre-Alzheimer, so be very sure, doctor. So telomerase must be there in your mind, about patient's story. So that means you are still a replicating cell. So it will be absent in a fully mature somatic cell, whereas it is abundant in germ cells, stem cell, cancer cells, etc., etc. So what is the best way that you can use certain anti-cancer drugs? You can use anti-telomerase or pro-telomerase. If you use an anti-telomerase, you can prevent multiplication of cells. That's how you use the various anti-cancer drugs. So telomerase acts like a reverse transcriptase. It carries its own RNA molecule, which is used as a template in order to create the DNA strands, which are telomeres, which are basically added to the three end of the DNA. That's what telomerase will be doing. Now, what happens in inflammation? ESR is very high. So what happens in anemia? ESR will be high or low? And what happens in polycythemia? Obviously, low or high? Low. So few concepts in our mind will be internally opposite logistically. Why? In inflammation, why ESR is high? Inflammation leads to a lot of fibrinogen. Fibrinogen will cause stacking of the cells by increasing viscosity. And stacking of the cells will lead to high ESR. That is the funda. But suddenly you remember polycythemic individuals have got a high viscosity. Then try to answer that ESR will be high there. There you can go wrong. So to win entrance, to be logical is also a disadvantage sometimes. But let me tell you, it is only disadvantage, yes, in 5% of occasions, but 95% of times it is an advantage. Don't blame the reasoning mind. So it is a Rolex formation due to high fibrinogen inflammation which is responsible. Now, acute lung injury versus acute respiratory distress syndrome. If you want to differentiate between the two, what is the factor that differentiates the two is an important question. Basically, you will be administering certain oxygen to the patient. It's called fraction of inspired oxygen, FiO2. And after inspiring oxygen, you will be checking his ABG, arterial blood gas analysis, and how is his arterial oxygen partial pressure. Did the PaO2 improved after receiving this amount of FiO2? You will check. Suppose if PaO2 by FiO2 is less than 300, you call it as acute lung injury. And if PaO2 by FiO2 is less than 200, that means what? Though you are giving high FiO2, if the PaO2 is only rising very little, that means oxygen therapy patient is not responding, then you call it as ARDS. So it is only by these two parameters that ALI and ARDS definitions do differ. So lot of the recent entrance exams questions on ARDS topic are regularly asked. So all the international definitions of ARDS, predisposing factors for ARDS, management of ARDS, everything you should be very sure about, doctor. This is another little above the sky kind of a question. Trimodal pattern of event is there after a trauma. What it represents on the y-axis? Actually, it is a question based on one graph in one journal. And that had been framed as a question. So, time between the onset of the injury and the death, if you take, it typically follows this kind of a trimodal pattern. So, what is being depicted on the y-axis is basically the mortality after a trauma. As the hours keep passing, it follows basically there is a more risky period of mortality, less risky period, like that. So that is all that simply this being picked up and framed as a question. But these are all rare questions. You don't answer them, also no problem. You still get seated. But there are some traditional questions I will show you. If you miss, only God can save you. God cannot even save you. So, ondansetron, for example, this is a very traditional question. Everybody will punch on this question and go forward. So, but the problem in entrance is, the question before like question may little disgust your mind. Following that, to answer this question, sometimes you may end up in answering it wrong. So it is like very close to our cricket. You get a spinner, he may irritate you. Then a pace bowler, you may end up in a clean bowl. Because the enough irritation the spinner gave you and gone. Ball was twisting on all sides and coming. So, but still it is the question of composition of mind. In spite of a bad question, you should be able to play well. Finally getting that 150-160 score out of 200 is all what we should aim for. So it suppresses the chemoreceptor trigger zone, ondansetron, where it is a 5-HT3 receptor against the serotonin is what need to be understood. Let us talk about the radioiodine in thyrotoxicosis. To give radioiodine, there are only two contraindications. One is pregnancy, which is an absolute contraindication. Second is, if a patient has got a thyrotoxicosis due to Graves' disease, in Graves, already if there is an ophthalmopathy, for such patient, if you happen to get iodine, one of the controversial thing is ophthalmopathy may worsen. So that can be a relative contraindication is what you have to be very sure about. Once more, remember, doctor, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, Graves' disease, De Quervain's thyroiditis, these are all the topics you have to be 200% sure. Radioactive iodine uptake, where is it increased, where is it diffusely increased, where is it decreased, what type of antibodies are positive in each of them. So there are certain set of around 800 topics which I will tell you in the end of the this discussion, which you have to study before you say that I am ready for any entrance exam. Be very sure. Now, what is the epithelial lining of respiratory tract? Typically, it starts as a pseudostratified epithelium, ciliated epithelium, finally it becomes, when it is alveoli, it becomes a simple squamous epithelium, because oxygen diffusion should occur only if it is simple squamous. Initially, in the upper respiratory tract, it will be pseudostratified ciliated epithelium, pseudostratified and then ciliated and then simple squamous is what need to be remembered. Where will you do tracheostomy? Fundamental question. Generally, lot of questions come on types of tracheostomy, complications of tracheostomy, one of the favorite topic. So between the second and third cartilages. So what do you have the structures here, doctor? You have the vocal cord, and here what you call 2 is thyroid cartilage, then you have a cricoid cartilage, and then you have tracheal rings, first tracheal ring, second tracheal, and this is the third. Between second and third tracheal ring you will be passing. So before you finish housemanship, if you can do at least 30 to 40 intubations and 3 to 4 tracheostomies, the life is fulfilled. Because if you become dermatologist anyway, you can't do. You can't intubate the underneath of dermis. So there is nothing to do as a dermatologist for all that. So also when you go to obstetrics posting thing, then last opportunity to deliver the babies. You don't know, you may be ending up in a honeymoon trip and need to deliver somebody. So the point is obstetrical midwifery is a skill anywhere, useful skill. So you have to, and obstetrics textbook is otherwise very bland if you have not gone to labor room, let me tell you. And because it's all like driving, steering only, no? Transfer slide, breech, Mauritius, simile maneuver, forceps, etc. is more like lorry driving. So the point is, you have not even got into the driving seat of lorry. There is a question of reading about book on lorry and something about driving. It remains only as an imagination for you. So that's the reason you have to take full advantage. Honeycombed appearance of the liver. Classically seen in the case of the putrefaction is one of the favorite questions of the examiner. Now this is another nagging question. It is called receiver operating characteristic curves. I leave this because this is not going to be the typical question in any other entrance exam. But I leave some literature for you to review about it. Now what is an advantage of an MRI compared to that of the CT? MRI gives better soft tissue delineation, CT gives better bony delineation, and calcification can be seen better with the CT is what you have to remember. 35 year old with secondary amenorrhea, pregnancy test was negative, prolactin level was normal, but the FSH is high and estrogen is low. So normally when the estrogen is low, FSH is low, then who is at fault? Pituitary or ovary? Pituitary. Estrogen is low but FSH is high means ovarian dysfunction. So I leave to you the algorithm of how to approach a case of secondary amenorrhea based on the hormonal profile. Anyway, we will discuss it in our regular class Monday to Friday in a great detail. Lot of questions come on endocrinological approach to the dysfunctional uterine bleeding and amenorrhea is a favorite topic of the examiner. Why homocysteine increases the risk of developing atherosclerosis? Assertion is true, reason is true, but reason is not the cause of the assertion. The reason is, true reason is, elevated homocysteine will cause oxidant stress, impaired endothelial function, and increased risk of thrombosis is what you have to be very sure about. Aerosol therapy, why do we use aerosols? To humidify and to deliver medicine, just like you give ipratropium, the budesonide, everything, na asthma mein nebulizer which we use, and expectoration promotion also will occur. So there are all the roles which are being played by the aerosol therapy. If UAA becomes UAG, then what is the result in the protein synthesized? You know very well that there are three stop codons in RNA. What are they? UAG, UAA, UGA. Otherwise, you go away, you are away, and you are gone. So the three codes. So even if one is replaced by the other, anyway it is going to be stop codon only. Right? If you failed in medicine, failure in surgery is not a big deal because anyway you are not going to proceed further. So that way. Now drugs A and B are being given, which are given intravenously every 24 hours, then how do you want to compare the two? Basically, the drug A does not maintain persistent therapeutic levels because the value of it is weaning down by 24 hours. So if you don't give a continuous infusion, then it is not going to maintain a persistent therapeutic level. That is what you can conclusively conclude from this particular graph. Then how does vancomycin, erythromycin, metronidazole act? Examiner don't want to ask three different questions. Straight one shot he want to hit you on all the three. Remember, doctor, there are totally 9 antibiotics. Tetracyclines, rifampicin, right? Penicillins and congeners, macrolide antibiotics, chloramphenicol. Which, S1, S2, AP Express compartments will be there, no? 70S, 30S, 50S, which S? It will go and inhibit. You have to be sure before getting into AP Express, before going to AIIMS exam. So, these are all around 90% of questions are standard issues. As an undergraduate, we are expected to be thorough with. Remember, doctor, that vancomycin is a cell wall synthesis inhibitor. You all agree? And erythromycin basically inhibits the protein synthesis by acting on the 50S subunit of the bacterial 70S RNA. And the metronidazole basically acts on the bacterial DNA directly. That is how the various drugs act. Now, you must have heard from your surgery teacher, there is a surgical wound. Have you started metronidazole or not? Why will he say? Because it is very active against anaerobic. Now, why only anaerobic? Because the metronidazole need to get converted. It need to be partially reduced before it goes and acts on DNA. And that can only occur in an anaerobic environment. So it is only effective against the anaerobes, not on aerobes or on the human cells. Because they don't provide that non-oxygen containing environment for the reduction of the metronidazole to happen, for it to become an active metabolite before it acts on DNA. Am I sure? Hope I am not too fast. So that's the point. Now, how to differentiate true from that of a false labor? True is regular. It increases progressively in frequency and duration. Pain is felt in abdomen radiating to the back. Progressive dilatation, effacement will be there. And membranes are bulging during contractions and it is not relieved by antispasmodics. The characteristic features of the true labor. You must be very sure when you go to the labor room posting. A woman aged 20 years, pain in hypogastrium, history of not passing urine since last 12 hours. 3 months, amenorrhea history is there. And typically the cervix is high under the pubic symphysis and separate mass palpable in pouch of Douglas. All these are talking about one simple clue. It is a retroverted gravid uterus, which is leading to development of urinary retention, which is the underlying diagnosis of this case in view of the history of amenorrhea and also the pervaginal examination findings. How do you relieve the portal hypertension? Classically, what is being depicted here is an example of a distal splenorenal shunt. What are you doing by doing distal splenorenal shunt, doctor? You know very well that inferior mesenteric vein and splenic vein, portal vein, they are all in close loop with one another. So, whenever there is a portal hypertension before splenorenal shunt, what is happening? There are a lot of varices across esophagus and the stomach because of the pressure which is there inside the portal vein. And here what you have is the inferior mesenteric vein, the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein joining into the portal vein. Agreed? So what is happening here? High portal venous pressure is preventing splenic vein from draining. And from splenic vein, the collaterals are developing through the stomach or the overlying the stomach surface towards the lower esophagus. So how can you be able to take care of this condition by doing distal splenorenal shunt? Typically the vein from the spleen is disconnected from the portal vein and it is reconnected to the left renal vein. Agreed? And the gastric vein is also disconnected from the portal vein and tied off. So how does the blood flow now? The blood flow from the varices through the splenic vein to the left renal vein and empties into the IVC. From IVC it will go to heart. You're able to get me? So basically we wanted to decongest the traffic jam here. So from gastric vein to splenic vein to renal vein to inferior vena cava. because this part of the high pressure in the portal vein is causing all the problem. And same time, portal vein is continuing to provide the blood to the liver from the intestine. You have not done anything. Okay, so that is how we conduct a distal splenorenal shunt to decongest the relieve the congestion in the gastric venous esophageal varices by providing an alternative conduction through splenic vein into the inferior vena cava is what need to be remembered. Now, whenever there is a peripheral vascular disease, angiogram is being given and asked, what is the surgical procedure you want to do? So, whenever there is any iliac occlusion or iliac stenosis, you have three options. You have to basically bypass this occlusion. For that, you can do iliac angioplasty and a crossover graft you can create. So that what is happening, the blood will flow from this conduit to the other lower limb. Or you can do a aortofemoral directly from aorta bypassing that stenotic area. Aortofemoral bypass graft you can do, or from the axillary vessels you can do an axillary femoral bypass graft you can do. There are the three various options which are available tomorrow. Some of you are going to be vascular surgeons. Conjugated hyperbilirubinemia, where do you come across? Dubin-Johnson. And in which condition you come across unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia? In case of Crigler-Najjar type 1 and type 2. Then how about the Gilbert syndrome? Conjugated or unconjugated? And what is so special about the Gilbert? No other liver enzymes are elevated. Alkaline phosphatase, SGOT, SGPT, everything is normal. Only isolated hyperbilirubinemia you will come across in somebody who had a history of fever, who had a history of exercise or stress, etc. And in them it is self-limiting. After a period of time it becomes typically resolved. So whenever somebody comes with jaundice to you, without any other enzyme elevation, you should immediately think of Gilbert and say there is a future good prognosis. That's what you are going to tell. Now, what skin lesion is excessive accumulation of stratum corneum? Typically, we call it as a scale. Scale is excessive accumulation of stratum corneum. Crust is a dried exudate of the body fluid. Erosion is the loss of epidermis without an associated loss of the dermis. Both dermis and epidermis is also lost, you call it as an ulcer. Oh, there is hell lot to read in dermatology called language of dermatologists. Though you don't want to become dermatologist, be very sure doctor, you want to be gynecologist also, still you have to read. That's called entrance. This is one simple table of Harrison, which is a useless book for entrance because it is already a volume overload in MD only. So, not for entrance at all. So, Davidson will also have all these definitions. Now, for a renal allograft recipient, if you want to avoid hyperacute rejection, now tell me doctor, what is the difference between hyperacute, acute and chronic rejection? Preformed antibodies prior to transplant responsible for hyperacute. Why preformed antibodies will form? Let us say that patient has received a lot of blood transfusions that will lead to allo sensitization, that will lead to preformed antibodies. So that guy, you have placed a transplant kidney, before you finish the sutures and about to wash your hand, already kidney is done, I mean is dead. In the operative field only it is dead, hyperacute. So how do you know whether there are any preformed antibodies and treat the patient accordingly? So, for that you have got two important tests. One is called as a cross match, lymphocytotoxic cross match. Second is ABO blood group typing. Why ABO blood group typing is done? If the recipient's blood group is A and kidney from whom you have taken is a B guy, then naturally there is a preformed antibodies against the B fellow in a A blood group guy. So he can't receive the kidney. If that is done, then kidney is gone in the surgical field only. So ABO typing, even if he is A, recipient is donor is also A, still there is a possibility of autoantibodies preformed that you will be knowing by doing lymphocytic cross match. So what is lymphocytotoxic cross match? You will be checking whether there are any IgG antibodies against the class 1 MHC molecules. If they are being detected, then there is a chance of hyperacute rejection. So that also you have to do before going for a transplantation. So a good number of you are going to be the future urologists regularly doing transplant, you will be very sure. Now a family of 8 has 2 grandparents, 2 parents, 4 children susceptible. Neither the grandparents, parents, no one is susceptible to measles, only 4 children are susceptible, and out of them one is a primary, and within a short time of 2 secondary cases have developed. What is secondary attack rate? So this is a straight pick from the definition of secondary attack rate in preventive medicine textbook. So what is secondary attack rate? Number of exposed persons who are developing the disease within the range of the incubation period divided by the total number of susceptible contacts. So out of them, how many are susceptible? I mean, how many develop? 2. 2 divided by 4 or 3? 3, because only 3 are secondary cases. So that is the reason that becomes 66.6%. Am I sure? I hope I am not sure to a lot of you. Because a good teacher always gets that whether the students understood or not. So a lot of times I know that students didn't understand, that I understood very clearly, but in spite of that we need to proceed ahead, because the point is this is simple mathematics which you have to just recheck it. Now left superior oblique muscle, this I am going to make you all understand, there is no doubt on that. What will be the head tilt in superior oblique? First of all, superior oblique is supplied by which cranial nerve, doctor? 4th cranial nerve. Excellent. Trochlear. You all agree? Now, whenever the superior oblique got paralyzed, the head will be tilted towards the opposite shoulder. That is a simple rule which you need to remember. That means a left superior oblique is paralyzed, it means the head is tilted towards the right shoulder. That is the only way you can prevent the diplopia. Okay. Now what is the function of superior oblique? Is it causing elevation or depression? Huh? Depression and adduction? Adduction or abduction? Abduction? Extorsion. Very good. So if it is not doing the role, who has to do that role? The head has to do that role. Agreed? So normally my left superior oblique is expected to depress my eye. So if it is not doing, my head will depress. Right? And it is expected to do basically extorsion. So since it is not doing, the only way is to basically tilt the head to the opposite side and do that extorsion. So head is tilted opposite side, opposite towards opposite shoulder with the looking downwards. That is what is basically happens with superior oblique. So downwards and towards the right shoulder becomes the answer. Now what is a very close differential diagnosis for the superior oblique palsy? It can be confused with what? The paralysis of the superior rectus of the opposite eye. That is, my right sided superior rectus paralysis will cause a similar diplopia like my left superior oblique paralysis. So how do you differentiate whether it is the paralysis of the superior rectus of the opposite eye or paralysis of the superior oblique of ipsilateral eye? How do you differentiate? We will not discuss that. I leave that small algorithm for you to review. But examiner can ask any question on extraocular muscles. All their twists, turns, movements, everything, you should be sure, like a karate kid. See in the movie? So you must be very sure on all those permutations. Now tell me, at least in conclusion, we will ask doctor, what is your good name? Yeah, yourself. yourself. No, no. Yeah, I'm talking to you. Yeah. No, 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 no. Yeah. Dr. Chandrakala? Huh? Yes, yes. So, which side superior oblique palsy it is? One confident answer, there are only two sides. No clues, please. Only question goes to Dr. Chandrakala, who is my examiner actually. In my MD exam, we had a Professor Chandrakala. So, only Chandrakala is going to tell. Which side he tilted the head, doctor? Right shoulder or left shoulder? Left, Adi. This is my right means the, her left. So left sided tilting means which sided superior oblique? Right sided superior oblique. Yeah, please say. So this is a typical compensatory left hand tilt for a congenital right superior oblique palsy is what need to be remembered. This patient has a bilateral superior oblique palsy. So if you happen to tilt his head towards the right side, then there is a right hypertropia, and left side there is a left hypertropia. So there is a development of a hypertropia whenever the head is tilted to the ipsilateral shoulder. That signifies that side a superior oblique palsy. Okay, so why it happens? Once more, you need to sit with the chart and coolly think why it happens. Few facts are better read rather than being explained. This is one such. Now, 54 year old becomes ill 3 days after eating Chinese fried rice. 3 hours, okay. What are the only two food poisonings which have a very short incubation period? Excellent. Staph aureus, Bacillus cereus. Very good. I am able to see a lot of 2012 toppers for the MD entrance, promising toppers from the MD entrance. So, who are going to play on pressure. So, now comes congenital condition which is being projected here. First of all, what is this condition you think? Is Hirschsprung's disease. So, congenital megacolon. So, whenever it occurs, this is a typical total colonic aganglionosis, and aganglionic segment is dilated, as all of you know. It is a typical barium minima which is showing the transition zone between the normal caliber innervated bubble and the aganglionic bubble which is basically dilated. So it is showing the typical transition, and typically this is a megacolon in once more the Hirschsprung's. Now how do they present? They fail to pass the meconium within first 48 hours is a typical presentation. And you should know the other differences between that of functional constipation, overflow incontinence and congenital megacolon. I don't go much into this topic because anyway we'll discuss it in our regular class. Now a 50 year old carcinomatous ulcer of the rectum, ulcer is 6 centimeters from the anal verge. On investigation T2N0M0, then there is no comorbid condition, how do you want to manage it? Now this is a very common question asked in the rectal anorectal carcinoma frequently in the entrance. Let us be very sure, doctor. For which scenarios low anterior resection is the most appropriate therapy? First of all, what is low anterior resection? See, a part of the sigmoid colon is having malignancy, doctor, rectum and sigmoid colon. You have removed that part, and the remaining part you create a anastomosis. So this is a simple low anterior resection. Agreed? So this is typically done if at all the cancer is in the upper 2/3 of the rectum. That is, it is far from the anal sphincter. And by doing this, what is the advantage? You are not disturbing the anal sphincter. Is it not a great help to the patient? Definitely. Because it prevents embarrassment in lot of social scenarios if the anal sphincteric patency is maintained and all your effort is to save that. So in this case, it is 6 centimeters away from anal verge. But it is so far. Why do you want to disturb anal sphincter? You don't want to. Hence, low anti-resection is considered to be the best option which is available in this given scenario. Then whereas in the abdominal perineal resection, what you are trying to do? Whenever the lesion is in the lowest part of the rectum, very close to anus, or if it is involving the anal musculature, that is the time where you will be basically doing the abdominal perineal resection. So in this, you will be removing the entire part including the anal sphincter, you won't save it. And then after removing it, you are basically making an external opening in the form of colostomy, which is basically later on closed by various methods.